mean.
That she's helpless.
But she won't be me.
That she's frightened.
Where are they?
That she's next. Catherine Ross. The Stepford Wives. Rated PG.
Now playing in a selected theater or drive-in near you.
This little can of Underwood Devil Pan is made with whole pans and natural spices, so it's got a big flavor that goes a long way. Mixed with relish, mayo, and celery, it makes zesty-tasting meat sandwiches for less than 25 cents a piece. And for even more value, look for Underwood supermarket displays telling how to get 50 cents worth of free soup. Underwood Devil Pan is a little can that goes a long way.
Tomorrow on the 3:30 movie, Elvis Presley turns Seattle into a musical happening.
See, one minute there's something in this eye, and the next minute there's something in this eye, and it goes back and forth.
Goes back and forth.
Well, if you look a little closer, maybe you could see what
I am. This way, please.
It happened at the World's Fair, stars Elvis Presley. The 3:30 movie for Friday, tomorrow here on Channel 7. See it on Channel 7 KABC TV, Los Angeles.
Wide World Special.
Convicted for those crimes, almost beyond belief. They were Charles Tex Watson, 23, an A student and star athlete before becoming a dropout. Susan Atkins, 21, from a middle-class background to hustler and topless dancer. Leslie Van Houten, 20, divorced parents, a former homecoming princess who used LSD. Patricia Krenwinkle, 21, divorced parents, sang in a church choir, a former campfire girl. Linda Kasabian accompanied the killers but didn't participate and was set free after turning state's evidence. Finally, Charles Millis Manson, fatherless, went from runaway to burglar to robber to forger to pimp. A 35-year-old songwriter who wanted to emulate the Beatles, he was charged with masterminding, ordering the killings, for motives which we'll explore in Charles Manson, A Portrait in Terror. Our guests, defense attorney Irving Kinnerick, prosecutor Vincent Bugliosi, psychologist Jeremy Ritzman, Manson family members Brooks Poston and Paul Watkins.
Y'all can't call medicine, and y'all won't want a drug. You got more sickness than you got cures of cancer of the mind.
My legs used to drag till I discovered
Sheer Energy,
the pantyhose with all-day massage. When I slipped them on, I felt their massage begin. That's because they're made with a special springy yarn that massages, refreshes, stimulates my legs.
This is saying 45 seconds.
If you're the kind of person who appreciates bread cheese flavor, Doritos brand nacho cheese flavored tortilla chips. Don't get a surprise you, especially when you taste nacho cheese flavored Doritos, because they taste as good as they crunch. Doritos nacho cheese, just one of three great Doritos flavors.
For the kids called cola, I used to give them aspirin. I trust it. But aspirin alone can't help sniffles. No, sniffles need something more. So now I give them congesperin, a children's cold tablet. Congesperin has the same amount of aspirin for fever as children's aspirin, plus a decongestant to help relieve stuffiness and sniffles. I trust congesperin. It helps more than aspirin because it is more than aspirin.
Why is a pretty nose like you need powder?
This cold has me all red. Pardon?
For stuffy noses and sinuses, try four-way nasal spray.
Oh, really?
Four-way's fast-acting formula starts to work in seconds. Gives you the fastest decongestant relief possible for noses and sinuses.
That's a blast.
Yes, it is, Miss Nose.
Mrs. Nose.
What?
Available in regular and mentholated.
The Manson trial lasted 9 months. During that time, these were the many faces of Charles Manson, who said, I may have implied that I may have been Jesus Christ, but I haven't decided yet what I am or who I am. What was it like to be a member of Charles Manson's family and under his influence? The answer to that may be much more significant than any court decision, because it throws light on what can happen in the darkest recesses of the human heart and mind. Now a member of his own rock group called Desert Sun, Brooks Poston at 18 was a Texas dropout and a Manson follower. His testimony helped convict his former guru. Brooks, where did you come to meet Charles Manson?
I met him in Los Angeles. On Sunset Boulevard. He was living with Dennis Wilson at the time.
Yeah, how come that he got involved with such a highly successful recording star like Dennis Wilson?
Dennis met the girls first. And he picked him up hitchhiking. And I think they told him about this wonderful fellow, Charlie. And then he expressed an interest to meet him, where they just brought him on.
Because of his music, though, or just generally?
Well, it probably looked like a really great place to live.
And Manson claimed to preach love. How did he get his followers from love to kill in one easy lesson?
Well, it wasn't one easy lesson, that's for sure. It was a slow, gradual process of changing the realities that the people in the family had. When they were young, when they first got to the family, they saw life from one particular point of view, you know, the one that they had grown up with. And then a little bit at a time, Charlie changed that point of view by making another point of view for them to look at. And he made that one so good and so outstanding,
yeah,
that they wanted to have that point of view for theirs. They wanted to become what he was.
Did he, when he was going through this process, did he ever ask any of your judgments or opinions? Or, I mean, was it just his,
no, definitely
his
not.
Word?
Definitely not. He said one of the things that he did was to tell us to give up our thinking. Give up thinking, give up being, give up your ego, give up being an I, give up being a personality.
Well, weren't you suspicious that he wanted absolute power over you?
Not at that point. I was really a pretty naive fellow.
Yeah. Is it true that he asked you to prove yourself by trying to die?
It wasn't a prove so much as, I guess he would have had pretty much total control over me if I'd done it. But I did try to die. I definitely did. He told me to give up my ego. And he told me that all that I saw, everything in this world, was imagination, God's imagination. And then he took it a step further, a little bit at a time, in a gradual process. And he told me that it was in my imagination. And then a few heavy acid trips and a few things like that. And I began to see that reality as mine. I took what he told me, and I looked out of Charlie's eyes, and I saw it exactly the way that he told me to see it. And so I saw my duty was to die. My duty was to give it up, which was also one of his terms, give it up.
How did you go about trying to die?
Well, the only way that I knew, and he may or may not have been talking about me giving up the ghost, but that was the only thing that I had in my mind, because that was the die that I had seen my father do. And he just flat did it. Absolutely died dead. And that was the only thing that I had to relate it to. Mm-hmm. Then when I saw things the way Charlie had told me to see them, from the way I related to the words,
Then
that was the only thing that I had to go by. That was the only die that I could associate with.
Yeah.
That was the one that I was headed for.
Once he had that control over you, how did he convince you to kill innocent people? Didn't they deserve to love?
Well, I didn't kill innocent people, but...
No, I know you weren't involved in those killings, and how did you free yourself?
I freed myself because Charlie freed me, inadvertently. He left where I was, and I didn't see him again for 8 months. In that 8 months' time, I was able to put my attention on something other than all of the programs in the family, than the doctrine and the dogma that Charlie laid down. Something other than Charlie, to regain Brooks. Because for a long time, it was not all right to be Brooks. Brooks was the last thing I wanted to be.
Brooks had lost his identity completely, almost.
Yeah, that was the object, to give up totally. Give up my thinking, give up all questions, don't question anything. Don't ever look at anything in any way other than the way Charlie would say it.
It's the old Nazi.
Total object.
Did he ever ask you to kill anybody?
Yeah, one time. He was up in the canyon. This was after the 8 months had gone by that I hadn't seen him. And he came back and he told us a few stories. One of the first ones he told us was about killing somebody that I knew, Shorty O'Shea. And I thought, well, this must be some kind of a far-out trick to get me back into the family. This is a nice ploy, but I don't think, you know, man, that's not Charlie. Charlie was all sweetness and light. So I didn't go for it right at first. And then he kept coming on a little stronger and a little stronger with his death games. And death, all the time death, whereas before, it hadn't been so much on the outside world as dying. as everybody in the family giving up that kind of dye. So now he changed it, and he started talking about killing people, other people. And he told me if I was with the family, that I would take a knife, which he had in his hand, small, and walk to Shoshone, which was 60 miles away, go in the sheriff's house and cut his throat. I looked at him, knowing that if I said all right and didn't do it, then I had opened the door, and it was just like asking to be killed. And if I said no, then I told him, no, I'm not with the family, and then I would have been killed. Either way, it's a double-headed question, so I didn't say anything.
Didn't he say that he loved Christ, that he was Christ?
Never in so many words. He implied it in a lot of ways. He had a lot of gestures when he would tell stories. And he told a story about an acid trip one time where he was on acid and he laid down on a mattress. And all of a sudden this acid took over. And he was laying down on his back with his arms outstretched like that. He felt incredible pains. And he went through the whole trip and he said there was a girl named Mary at his feet crying. The whole thing going together to play on what we already knew about the Bible. To use our own imaginations, we could fill in the blank spots. So it was more of an implied gesture than an outright on Christ. But he did say he was love, which is a basic part of the programming.
Yeah, but nobody asked him to walk in the water.
No.
Let me ask you this. What was the hole in the ground? Paradise.
That was a place we were going to escape to when Helter Skelter came down. The family was going to go there, and there were other tuned-in races. We were supposed to be very tuned-in people. There were other tuned-in races already living there, the people that had been conquered, like the Aztec. The nice, peaceful people had just vanished from the face of the earth and gone underground where they were living. And it was supposed to be a cavern that would hold everybody and have a river of milk and honey and trees with 12 different kinds of fruit. Everything was straight out of the Bible. And at first, I'm sure most of us were alike in looking at it. It sounded, you know, well, it's all right, but, you know, is it real? But then you look at Charlie, and if in your head Charlie equals Christ, and you hear Christ telling you that there is a cavern underground, then the next thing to do is turn that equation in and say, well, that means it's there. We're going to look for that hole.
What was your background before this whole thing?
I lived in Texas, and I was pretty frustrated, to say the very least. When I lived in a little town called Borger, I used to watch television. I'd see Haight Ashbury on TV, and I'd see long-haired kids running around, and they had flowers in their hair, and they were smiling, looking like they were having a good time. And I definitely was not. I wasn't satisfied with where I was, what I was doing, who I was with.
What have you learned from this whole experience?
There's almost too much to sum up in a brief statement.
Yeah. What are you doing right now?
Playing music.
Yeah.
And using what I have learned, which is how I got in and out of the family, which would take far too long to explain in one session, to tell other people, you know, to illustrate points, to demonstrate that maybe all of this believing, which I was in, I was very naive. I believed anything anybody told me almost. And with the help of a few friends like Charlie and some good acid and good weed, coupled, not that the acid and weed are the bad, but the Charlie's presence.
Yeah. How would you sum up Manson in a single sentence?
That he was a genius. And, well, there's the fine line. A genius with so much potential. And he got power hungry, and he saw that it worked, the games that he learned, and he went crazy with power.
You've seen too many Hitler movies. Bruce, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good luck with your music. Next, Paul Watkins discusses his sojourn with the family.
I'm so lucky for the friend. It's just perfect. Just better every day.
followers. They echoed his moods, his appearance, even like him, mutilating their own flesh. Another member of the Manson family was an 18-year-old California youth whose testimony was a powerful link that condemned Charles Manson, Paul Watkins. Paul, what role did you play in the Manson family?
I played the role of one who came in that had already experienced quite a bit of LSD and the hippie way of life. I wasn't blown off my tracks by the whole thing, more or less. And I also had a particular value to Charlie, as that was I got along well with his girls. Mm-hmm. And he saw me, I was quite a bit younger than him. He saw me as being a lure for other young women. That gets played up quite a bit by the press, and has been in the last few years. It's not actually, that somewhat makes me some sort of a pimp. But actually it wasn't so. I brought a few girls to the family, and so did every guy that had girlfriends. My role was more or less one who couldn't figure out why this guy had 10 girls and wanted to stay around and find out exactly how that was possible.
That's interesting. What was Manson's attitude toward these girls?
His attitude towards them was that he summed it up to me like this. He says, this is a planet of women. We are aliens here. And you better watch out, because they'll tie you up and catch you up in their game. Otherwise, it's a very nice place to live, strictly on account of them.
Just to get back to what you said, what you said before, why have so many girls around?
Why have so many girls around?
To do all the work.
Well, not only that, I could see that he'd have a lot of girls around because he'd been in jail for so long, and there weren't that many girls around. And because in a group sex situation, it is best to have more girls than boys, and there was a lot of group sex in the family.
Yeah, and the studies of the Manson family mentioned orgies at the Spahn Ranch. What special role did Manson play in those?
More or less that of a sculptor, you know, who would direct. Actually, he played the very center role.
He would orchestrate
the whole thing. He would instigate motions and moves. This was very hard to learn for the family, how to let him do this. It was a little hard for him to teach the family how to.
He had to get their heads in the proper place before they...
Right. They always talk about orgies, and they talked about how they were so far out and all this. Actually, that wasn't really true. It was really hard to get something like that on. It didn't work too good at all. It never really worked the way we theoretically thought it was going to.
Although he wanted it to.
The way he wanted it to, do you have in a group sense? Never did.
No, those odds are a little high, so I'm sure. Manson claimed to preach love. How did he get his followers from love to kill?
Well, that's... Okay, it sounds really absurd, but it can be done. I'll explain it to you. It goes, first of all, you can say, well, I love you. And if you love me, well, will you light my cigarette? You say, yeah. Well, if you love me, would you kill me if I ask you to? Do you love me that much? Okay, you love me that much? Well, then, would you kill someone else if I ask you to? See, it's a progression.
Yeah.
It didn't happen as fast as it just happened now. It happens over a period of a year or two. Slowly. And then also, it's a matter of removing the programs. You have to go deep, and this is where LSD comes in very handy. You go very deep and take those programs out. This is where I saw some real damage being done, potentially, when I watched Charlie doing this. He would go right in and take the, say you have a thou shalt not kill in there when you're 3 years old.
Mm-hmm.
You go right in there, take that out. This is where you use Scientology processing to go in and reprogram a mind. Now, the person who's having this done to him is not really even aware that he's been reprogrammed, or that a program has been removed from his early life.
When
you know he is.
Yeah, it's heavy. When you were under acid and the other kids, was he under acid too? Was he in total control?
Both. He took acid and he was usually under control. I did see one trip, and I was the one who gave out the doses of acid, and I saw to it that everybody took two hits, and it was very strong. Charlie did lose it on that trip, but usually he would take a little. Everyone took a little or more than he did. Sometimes less.
But
he never lost control. He was good. That's interesting. Most definitely. What did all this have to do with his plans for Helter Skelter? I don't know to this day that most of what I went through had anything to do with his plans for Helter Skelter, although I did see a pattern. Like I say, I saw it as being dangerous when I saw him removing his implants and making killing all right. I saw it from a point of view of having your head together and being able to be at peace with yourself that one should get to the point to where he wasn't hung up about anything. But then I saw that once these programs were removed, it would be easy to program that person to kill because they didn't have an anti-program against killing. And so that's what made me, that's why it hit me so hard that Charlie, that's why I left the family. I saw he was going to kill, and I saw it was very, very possible that they were too.
Yeah, you weren't involved in those killings, we know that. But how did you free yourself?
I just left one day. Charlie told me he was going to show Blackie how to do it. And Helter Skelter, Helter Skelter's not coming down the way it should. I'm going to have Blackie how to do it. Because the only thing he knows is what Whitey told him. This is what Charlie would say. So I knew what this meant. And so I left. I went to the desert. Brooks was there. And I got to talking with him. And this other guy, Paul Crockett, was there. And he got to asking me questions. And it made me look at myself. And I had a feeling like, I got to get back to the family. I got to go back there. But yet, I loved where I was. I was in the desert. I was happy. I didn't want to be in the family. It was crazy. It got absurd. The motorcycle people coming in. Helter Skelter was getting out of hand. We weren't making love anymore. So I went back and I asked Charlie to release me of all his agreements, all the agreements that we had in common. But then it was a matter of years sorting out my head. That's really where I got.
Let me ask you this, because back in old gangster days, you know, you could never leave a gang, you know, because
right.
What was his reaction when you said, you know, relieve me of any implication or whatever?
It was far out, because I hit him with it in front of the whole family. They were all there.
That is
and I said, Charlie, Brooks and I and Juanita would like to be released of all our agreements. He said, oh, sure, fine, I'll release you of all your agreements. So far, I was gone the next day, and I saw him a couple months later after the murders. He came up to Barker Ranch, and the first thing he said to me was, no, I don't release you of all your agreements. It's too late, partner.
How would you sum up Manson in one single sentence?
Oh. I would say that he was a very potentially powerful man, that he had something, most definitely had something very powerful and beautiful, and that he abused it, and that possibly the power got to him and he became power mad with it.
Got off the track with it.
I said possibly he could have done beautiful things. I saw that he could have done beautiful things.
Paul, thank you very much.
Thank you for looking.
Roman Polanski talks about the murders, and District Attorney Vincent Bugliosi discusses his prosecution of the Manson case after this message.
That's rare that Polanski.
I got bitten by that 24-hour bug the other day. I brought it right home to the family. One by one, everybody in the house got that bug. The cramps, the nausea, the common diarrhea. We felt miserable. Thank goodness for Pepto-Bismol. Pepto-Bismol coats, soothes, protects. It relieves that nausea while it controls the common diarrhea. It helped us get through bug time with a minimum of misery.
What do you say to your mother when she brings you some jello pudding? What do you say to your mother if she brings you a sack and I'll bring you jello pudding? What do you say to your mother if she brings you a frog and puts it in your face?
Thank you, mother.
If you've got kids, you've got to have pudding. And with Jell-O Brand Instant, you can have it ready in 10 minutes.
Thank you, mother.
Remember milk chocolate when it was creamy and smooth and thick? Well, for over 100 years, Cadbury has been, and still is,
like chocolate used to be. Solid or filled with wonderful surprises like nuts and raisins, caramel and peppermint. So,
how can you say you
chocolate?
So congested I can hardly breathe. Caramel.
Use Dristan Nasal Mist. Dristan is a combination of ingredients you don't find in the plain decongestant spray. Dristan does more to relieve nasal congestion. Look, both the other spray and Dristan open occasional clogged passages, but Dristan does more. Dristan helps dry up sinus areas with a special antihistamine the other spray does not have. Dristan does more to relieve nasal congestion. Dristan, nasal mist or vapor spray.
Special will continue with Charles Manson, A Portrait in Terror, an unauthorized biography following station identification.
Find out why the critics are raving about Hot L Baltimore tomorrow night.
Tomorrow, stick your running orange juice and have Libby's tomato juice instead. You'll get three times the vitamin A to help keep your skin nice and smooth. You'll get vitamin C, too. 6 ounces at breakfast give you 40% of the recommended daily allowance. And you get half the calories and half the carbohydrates of orange juice, which is nice for your figure. Now you know why a beautiful woman has never been called an orange.
Today, at a high-level meeting, Volkswagen engineers announced to their management that the new Volkswagen Rabbit averages an incredible 38 miles to a gallon down the highway, goes from 0 to 50 in a swift 8.2 seconds, and costs only $29.99. Management's reaction?
Happy days are here again.
Furniture Sale. A great opportunity for you to stretch your dollars now through Monday night. Don't miss it.
Elvis, tomorrow at 3:30.
Hi, Mr. Ross. Here's your order. Thanks, Joe. We'll see you.
When you take home Kraft Thousand Island Dressing, you can be sure it's made with 100% natural flavors. It's sweet with real bits of pickle relish, rich with golden egg yolk, spicy with red pepper, and tangy with sweet onion. Rich, thick Kraft Thousand Island Dressing. Because at Kraft, we think salads ought to be fun.
Test your shopping skills. We're preparing a main dish of one pound of hamburger, golden macaroni, sizzling cheddar cheese sauce, and special seasonings. It tastes as delicious as it looks. Now, what do you think this costs per serving? $1.25, 75 cents, 57 cents, 35 cents. The answer is, with Hamburger Helper, less than 35 cents a serving, including the cost of the hamburger. Hamburger Helper, 9 delicious ways to fight inflation.
I can tell you the last few months, as much as last few years I spent with her. The only time of true happiness in my life.
Following the sensationalism of the murders, Roman Polanski, Sharon Tate's husband, held a press conference. He felt compelled to defend the honor of his dead wife.
Lot of newsmen who for a selfish reason write unbearable for me horrible things about my wife. All of you know how beautiful she was, and very often I read and heard statements that she was one of most beautiful, if not the most beautiful woman of the world. But only few of you know how good she was. Sharon not only didn't use drugs, she didn't touch alcohol, she didn't smoke cigarettes. She was vulnerable. She couldn't refuse any friendship. thoughts, which are true. There was constant party. There wasn't an evening without a few friends. Even when I was working hard, even if she was working hard, there was always somebody coming in the evening. There was always Sharon. Waiting. I saw her last time for her.
The job of trying to send Charles Manson to the gas chamber for the Tate LaBianca murders fell to a young deputy DA, Vincent Bugliosi. Bugliosi has just written his account called Helter Skelter. The book reveals Mr. Bugliosi as a shrewd, tireless investigator who spent up to 100 hours a week for nearly 2 years to nail Manson, and did. Mr. Bugliosi, you have a book on the bestseller list, which you wrote in November, just came out, Helter Skelter, which, by the way, I read over the weekend. I think it's excellent. It's been more than 5 years since those murders. Why the continuing, almost morbid fascination?
I think, Peter, the reason is that these murders were not like any other murders we've probably had in the annals of American crime. Your typical mass murderer is someone like Speck in Chicago, Corona in California, Whitman gets up on the tower in Texas and mows down 12 people. Basically low-intellect, skid row, drifter types who flip out and they go on a murder spree and they commit the murders all by themselves. Manson, on the other hand, is a very bright guy, an IQ of about 121. He did not commit the murders himself. He had this incredible ability to get other people, this power to get them to murder for him at his command. And who were the killers? Well, they were kids from average American homes, young girls and boys. And it was an incredible family, a group of people.
How is it possible for him to control these young people that you're talking about, to kill absolute strangers for him?
Well, I think there were many factors that went into play. He was their king. They were killing for him. They were trying to please him. Also, I think a common denominator among all the killers is that they had a deep-seated hostility towards society before they met Manson. Mm-hmm. And you might say that Manson was the catalyst that translated this pre-existing rage into violence and ultimate murder. Also, I think he depersonalized prospective victims in his family's minds. They were symbols of the establishment. They weren't human beings. Of course, it's easier to stab a symbol than it is to stab a human being. And believe it or not, Peter, and I think you might find this interesting, being an actor, there was a certain amount of theater involved in these murders, as there frequently is when you have killings and death on a mass scale. Hitler dressed up 80 million Germans in costumes, basically, and at least in the dying gasp of the Third Reich, had them act like they were performing in some type of a heroic, bloody Wagnerian opera. Mm-hmm. The people of London performed very heroically under a hail of bombs in the Second World War because Churchill cast them in the role of heroes. Right. And they performed their heroic role on a stage lighted by a burning world city. Manson convinced his, you might call them bloodthirsty robots, that actually they were heroic historical gladiators whom he was sending out on a glorious mission to start a worldwide revolution that would bring about a new and better social order. In that context, the act of killing isn't quite as difficult.
Yeah, well, his purpose, I thought, was to start a racial war.
Yes, but it was a worldwide war between blacks and whites. He got this out of Revelation 9. He said the Beatles were talking to him through the lyrics of their songs. And the title of the book, Helter Skelter, this was a name that Manson gave to this black-white war, which he was trying to start by framing black people for the murders. And he had many sophisticated ways he was going to do it. The most obvious way was when he had Linda Kasabian plant Rosemary LaBianca's wallet in a gasoline station restroom in the black community of the San Fernando Valley. He was hopeful that a black person would find the wallet, use the credit cards, get caught, and therefore be implicated in these murders.
He was dumb, was he?
Those two words, I might add, were printed in blood. Helter Skelter, those words were printed in blood on the refrigerator door at the LaBianca residence. Mm-hmm. And that's the title of a Beatles song. It's called Helter Skelter.
Take it. During the trial, Manson would sometimes rap with you off the record. What kind of things did he say? Well, he'd say things like Hitler had the right answer for everything, that Hitler was a tuned-in guy who leveled the karma of the Jews. With respect to our conversations, prosecutors normally don't talk to defendants. But this was the longest murder trial we've ever had, 9.5 months. And Manson knew that I couldn't use anything he told me against him because he wasn't being advised of his constitutional rights. And I wanted to gain an insight into this very evil guru so that if and when he took the witness stand, I'd be able to crack him on cross-examination. So we had many conversations like this, perhaps the most revealing of which is when he told me that he couldn't care less for these girls. He says, I'm the most selfish guy in the world. And here these girls looked up to him as Christ. They thought he was Christ. They were willing to murder for him. They were willing to go to the gas chamber for him. And he's telling me he couldn't care less for them.
He admitted to being a sexist.
Pardon?
He admitted to being a sexist.
Oh, yeah. He was not only a racist, but to him, women were totally subservient. And the girls in the family, their sole purpose in life was to cater to the men if they have children.
The man said, I'm going to try to psych you out.
At the beginning of the trial, we had a staring session. He was always staring at people. He and I went at it for about 20 minutes, and he didn't budge, and I couldn't afford to budge. He was trying to gain control over my mind.
Was it true that he really had piercing?
Yeah, it's kind of hypnotic, Hitlerian-type eyes. And finally, he started to tremble, which he frequently did when he got nervous. So I moved my chair over to him. I said, what's wrong, Charlie? And he says, well, he says, you think I'm an evil guy, and I'm not. He says, I wouldn't step on a flower. He says, I like animals. And I said, well, that doesn't really mean too much, Charlie. While the furnaces were stoking at Auschwitz, Hitler and the rarefied atmosphere of Berchtesgaden and the high up in the Bavarian Alps was very concerned over the health of his dog, Blondie. So the fact that you like animals really doesn't mean that much to me. So we rapped for quite a while. And finally, I told him that I'd like to have a conversation with him on the witness stand. I may have overplayed my hand. I was always goading him and challenging him to take the witness stand.
Did you have any sympathy for Manson himself, I mean, as a human being, for his tragic background?
Well, I'm able to sympathize with Manson as a child. He had a very deprived, fractured childhood. His mother was a woman of loose circumstances, lived with a succession of uncles, didn't care for him at all. But many people had deprived backgrounds like Manson and didn't end up mass murderers. As an adult, of course, he's an extremely evil guy, and I'm able to dichotomize in my mind for his childhood, for which I do have some sympathy, and his life as an adult, for which, of course, I have no sympathy at all.
More about Charles Manson next.
My opinion, the thicker the steak, the better. The same with the sauce. Thick like Heinz 57. Hi, I'm Chef Mike Roy. Put Heinz 57 next to this other leading steak sauce. See, this sauce is thin. Runs, separates. But Heinz stays thick and rich with a spicy flavor you can get your teeth into. Heinz 57. The thicker, the better.
Food twins were exactly alike, except I use liquid bath oil. I use Calgon bath oil beads. My leading liquid makes my skin feel soft. The moisturizer at Calgon bath oil beads makes my skin feel just as soft. And it's one big difference. Calgon leaves just enough oil, watch. Well, liquid oil doesn't leave. Look what liquid oil left on your skin. Gee, can I borrow your Calgon? Calgon bath oil beads, but you want to feel soft, not slippery.
This is Physikim.
Yes.
The old diaper shaped inside with these exclusive folds that keep wetness from spreading. Would you help me? Would you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Pour that water right in. All the good stuff running. There you go, the whole thing. Now that's a lot of water, right?
Yes.
That's probably more water than a diaper's supposed to hold, right?
Yes. You're kidding me.
Kimby's, the dry sheet that keeps wetness from spreading.
I can't believe it. You poured that whole glass of water.
A recent nationwide survey asked independent TV service technicians about color TV. Here's what happened. This brand was named more than any other as the color TV needing fewest repairs. This brand was named as having the best picture. And this brand, the color TV they would buy today. The names? Zenith. 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 Shouldn't your next color TV be a Zenith? At Zenith, the quality goes in before the name goes on.
One of the girls bragged about stabbing Sharon Tate and tasting her blood.
Another said, stabbing was almost like having an orgasm. Right? How in the world do you explain that?
I think we're going to have a psychiatrist on the show later. He might have an answer for that. But he actually converted these people, as I say, into bloodthirsty robots. And he never told them, Peter, that if you don't murder for me, I'm going to murder you. They weren't operating under that state of fear. They enjoyed these killings. There was a certain amount of gusto involved. Many of the wounds were post-mortem wounds. There was 169 stab wounds. One of the psychiatrists at the trial testified that Leslie Van Houten, when she was stabbing one of the victims, she was taken out of rage to kill on her own mother. The point that has to be made is that although every member of that family was totally and slavishly obedient to Charles Manson, not every one of them would kill for him. Linda Kasabian, on the night of the LaBianca murders, he gave her a knife and instructed her to go inside an apartment house in Venice and slit the throat of an actor friend whom she had met a couple weeks earlier. And Linda, who thought Manson was Christ, said, Charlie, I am not you. I cannot kill anybody. Those that did kill for Manson, in my opinion, they already had that rage to kill, and he's the one that brought it to the surface.
And because he's married, he's not a man.
Well, one of the witnesses described him, Charlie's a heavy dude. He's someone to reckon with. He's an extremely evil guy. He has a magnetic personality wherever he went in the hippie world. People gravitated towards him, and for some strange reason, within a short period of time, he was dominating them. Like a classic example, one of the members of the family was 14 years of age, joined the family. Her father was a Methodist minister, and when he found out about this, he was intent that he was going to give Charlie a verbal dressing down, and he went to Spawn Ranch where the family lived, and in about a week, he was following Manson. So Manson, yeah, the father was. So he does have a powerful personality. He's not the typical mass murderer that we've been accustomed to in American history. And with the exception of a hired killing situation or a war situation, I can't think of any precedent in the annals of American crime where some guy has gotten other people to murder for him on a mass scale.
Now, let me ask you this. What would have happened if Manson and his family had not been captured after these murders?
If they hadn't been captured, they would have continued killing. That was their lifestyle. They traveled around preaching love. They're always talking about love. Susan Atkins says, you know, you really have to have a lot of love in your heart to do what I did to Sharon Tate. So their whole lifestyle was killing. The book Helter Skelter focuses in primarily on the 7-8 LaBianca murders, but we point out in the book the very real possibility that this family of murderers may have killed as many as 35 people. And they already had elaborate plans to murder Liz Taylor and Burton, Frank Sinatra, Tom Jones, Steve McQueen. There would have been further murders. I don't think there's any question about it.
During the trial, other Manson followers were on the loose.
Yes.
Were they dangerous? Are they dangerous?
No question about it. During the trial, look what happened. One of the defense attorneys, Ronald Hughes, vanished from the face of the earth. His body was found later on in a decomposed condition in the forest in Ventura County. And subsequent to that, a member of the family said that Ronald Hughes was the first of the retaliation murders. One of my star witnesses, Barbara Hoyt, the girls on the outside, they talked her into going to Honolulu. They checked into the Hilton there, and eventually they gave her an LSD-laden hamburger. Yeah. And yes, and drove her wild. She started running through the streets of Honolulu. She almost died. She came to, and their plan backfired because initially she was somewhat reluctant to testify against the family. But when they tried to kill her, then she came back to L.A. and she was one of my star witnesses.
Did the family ever threaten you during the trial?
Yeah, I was on Manson's death list, and I had a bodyguard for about a year and a half. And even though he did threaten to kill me, for some reason he always wanted to rap with me.
Are Manson's followers dangerous now, do they?
Yes, Manson is in Folsom. He's serving a life sentence. Originally, Manson and his followers, as you know, were sentenced to death, but the U.S. Supreme Court abolished the death penalty. They made their ruling retroactive, so no, Manson is serving a life sentence. There are still four or five girls, hardcore members of the family, with X's on their foreheads, still thinking that he's Christ. They're living in Sacramento, which is about 30 miles from Folsom, and I think potentially they're still very, very dangerous.
And there's a story that one young deputy DA got friendly with these girls in this upround where they're living now, and his wife baked cookies for them, and he said that the group was beautiful. I mean, how did that happen?
Well, it's a strange group. If you ever read Eric Hoffer's true believer. These people are right out of Eric Hoffer. They're personable. They're very friendly. They can sit down and talk to you the way I'm talking to you right now. And they're very disarming, and they fooled quite a few people. Manson's a con man. I mean, how many psychiatrists did he con in the 23 years that he's been behind bars? So it's a strange thing. They're very friendly. They have a smile on their face. Totally impervious to reason. They're pleased. They're happy. They found the answer to everything, and their answer is Charlie.
Extraordinary. There's one question I want to ask you because we're running out of time. It's actually a more personal question. Including Manson, you once had 8 people on death row waiting for the gas chamber.
Did that ever bother you? Did that ever bother me? I'm not a rigid exponent of the death penalty. I do think, however, that it does have its place in the overall administration of justice. I do feel that the death penalty does deter some premeditated killers. Most people bent on murder are going to commit the murder with or without the death penalty, but some people, we have evidence of this, they've admitted on tape that they were about to pull the trigger on a liquor store proprietor or a police officer, and they thought of the gas chamber, and they did not kill. I think a reasonable substitute for the death penalty would be life in prison without the possibility of parole, but we don't have that. Life in prison does not mean life in prison.
How would you sum up Manson in one single sentence?
A very sophisticated con man, a cold-blooded murderer who cleverly masqueraded behind the common image of a hippie, that of being peace-loving, and a very magnetic personality, very powerful guy.
That's very, very interesting. Thank you, Mr. Williams, so much.
Thank you, sir.
Attorney Irving Kinnerick explains his defense of Manson. Next.
Say, you wouldn't sweep dirt under the rug.
Never.
Rub dirt on your kitchen floor.
Never, ever.
That's what you're doing with a mop and shine product that builds up.
What?
Switch to Johnson Step Saver, the mop and shine product that doesn't build up. Each new coat of Step Saver dissolves its old coat, floats ground in dirt loose for your mop to pick up, then leaves a fresh, clean shine every time. Try Johnson Step Saver and end dirty buildup.
Forever.
Hi, Jenny. My garden coat's dropping in any minute. Please test the furniture.
I'll do better. I'll give the beautiful real wax shine.
There's no time.
If there's time to dust, there's time for Pledge.
Pledge?
Sure. It's so easy. You should use Pledge every time you dust. Pledge can give your furniture real wax beauty instantly.
What a shine.
And all I did was dust.
The flowers look lovely.
So does your furniture.
Oh.
Pledge. Wax beauty instantly every time you dust.
It's talking.
It's funny what you hear when you listen to a bowl of Kellogg's Rice Krispies.
It's popping. It's making crackling noise.
Pop, 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 pop.
Like that.
Kellogg's Rice Krispies. The world's only talking cereal. And a crisp, nutritious part of your complete breakfast.
It's time to put Snap Crackle Pop into your life.
Listen for yourself.
Why is the wilderness more desirable for you now than perhaps the ordinary life that we all have?
Well, I really do thank you.
Linda Kasabian accompanied the Manson killers but didn't participate and became the star prosecution witness. Yeah. After which she was freed and reflected on what she learned.
How do you describe hippie now? What does that mean if it has any meaning?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Well, my definition of a hippie was a person that was down to the earth, that wanted to get back to the land, and that their sole purpose was to get to God.
Does that kind of life have any meaning for you anymore? Will you continue that mode of life?
As being a hippie, to my definition?
Yes.
To defend Manson and his family for such bizarre and brutal murders took no small measure of courage. Manson's lawyer was Irving Kinnerick, a wily veteran of hundreds of court battles. Kinnerick says Bugliosi fought as if he personally were on trial. Mr. Kinnerick, you claim Manson is innocent. Why couldn't you convince a jury of that?
Well, Mr. Manson was lynched by public opinion. Before the jury came in, they'd had their minds made up. They knew what the verdict would be. For instance, one of the jurors, He was that prospective juror was asked, and he hadn't heard a word of evidence. He was asked, do you believe in the death penalty? And he said, not in this case. I believe in torture and then death. And he hadn't heard a word of evidence.
Excuse me, you said that the jury was afraid of Manson. But if they were afraid of retribution from his family, they'd have freed him, not convicted him, shouldn't
they? No, I'm not saying that the jury was afraid of Manson. What I'm saying is the publicity. You see, in the ordinary jury trial, after the jury tries the case, they recede into anonymity. In this case, these jurors were on the national or international scene for many months. And so this conditions their thinking.
Did you try for a change of venue?
Oh, yes, we made a motion for change of venue.
You told the jury that Manson was being persecuted at large because of his lifestyle, because he liked girls. Now, are you telling us that he was incapable of murder?
What I'm telling you is that all of that was irrelevant.
He was capable of killing murders?
No, his lifestyle, the fact that he likes girls, the sex. They even used a sex orgy. They had Linda Kasabian testify to a sex orgy. Now, what's that got to do with murder? Nothing.
Is it also true that he didn't like the way, when he didn't like the way that you were handling the case, that Manson threatened numerous times to kill you?
Well, first of all, a lawyer owes an obligation not to, if I was your lawyer, I would have the same obligation, not to reveal confidences, anything that has gone on in the attorney-client privilege within that context. And because you say that, doesn't make it so, Mr. Lawford.
Yeah, didn't you also, Manson in open court threatened the judge and then tried to attack him and screamed, his head should be cut off?
Now, let's put it this way. Does that prove murder? In other words, looking at that scene, what does that mean? Does it mean that a man is culpable, or does it mean that the man realizes the unfairness of what the prosecution has done in this case? I mean, the human species can only take so much pressure. And when you consider what they did, they deliberately structured the case with the mass media. So that Chief Davis, for instance, said that the case is solved. Now the jury's out there listening to that. They deliberately went out to capture that jury before the trial even started.
Well, let me ask you this question then. I mean, do you include Judge Oler in this? Because if you had such a strong case, and I have it here, and I may read it to his quote, Judge Oler stated, I have come to the regretful conclusion that Mr. Kinnerick appears to be totally without scruples, ethics, and professional responsibility so far as this trial is concerned. Now, why would he say that?
Well, Judge Boulder, he is entitled to his opinion. Judge Boulder, however, is a human being like you or like I am. I can show you other places in that transcript where Judge Older made complimentary remarks towards me. But that really isn't the point. The point is, was the jury given evidence that entitles them to bring in a verdict against Mr. Manson? And that evidence doesn't exist. Judge Older's opinion, my opinion, really, they may be interesting chit-chat, but that isn't the heart of the problem. The heart of the problem is the evidence.
And let's see that for a minute. Everyone knows lawyers cost a lot of money.
Oh, my God.
Which presumably Manson doesn't have. Are you still handling him because you think he is innocent? Or is it because it's good publicity for you? Or is it both?
Well, I just can't answer that question. I think the relationship between a lawyer and his client in that situation is such that it just I cannot speak to that matter. Any more than if I represented you, would you want me to tell the world about our relationship in that regard?
Not really, no. Would you have ever defended a client who you know is guilty of sin?
The Business and Professions Code of the State of California says words to this effect, that when you defend someone, it must be a just cause, referring to a civil case. But in a criminal case, that is not necessary. And the Business and Professions Code makes it clear that in a criminal case, the guilt or innocence does not deprive a lawyer of the duty, in fact, to defend someone. Now, I don't want, by making that statement, to imply that there's any question, but what this evidence shows that Charles Manson is innocent. But, and furthermore, the burden's on the prosecution.
At the risk of being facetious, and after listening to all the eloquent defense lawyers protecting their clients, did you ever wonder just who is committing all the crimes and murders in America today?
Well, you have to look at each case individually. When you look at each case individually, you then come up with an individual answer. For instance, I'm sure you heard his case in New York, where this lady was accused of I think killing two of her children. Ultimately, that lady was freed. There was an atmosphere around that trial where evidently that lady couldn't get a fair trial.
Well, I'm afraid we're running out of time, but just one last question. How would you sum up Manson in a single sentence?
I would have to decline because I'm his lawyer. I have an obligation to a client not to go into that kind of situation.
Mr. Kennedy, thank you very much.
Right.
Psychologist Jeremy Ritzlin analyzes the murders next on Charles Manson, Portrait in Terror.
You are about to witness a crime, an unsuspecting trap, her wallet buried safely in a canvas bag. Watch closely.
I'm going to end up the commercial.
Don't carry cash. Carry American Express traveler's checks. Now, there are other brands of traveler's checks, but they're not the same. Only American Express can give you emergency refunds 365 days a year. So insist on American Express traveler's checks.
Cool, huh? Can you hear me like that? I missed the first part.
Are you ready?
We're ready, Ella.
All right, fellas.
Dr. Riddle, you've been arranging the Ella Fitzgerald Jazz Sound for years. Yes, that's right. Can you tell if that's Ella live or a recording on Memorex cassette tape with MRX to one side? No, I can't. That sounds live to me. Is it live or is it Memorex?
Hey, Woody Walters, rock drummer. How's your love life?
Our last tour covered 72 cities, including M.
Woody! Hey, Woody! Your love life? How is it?
Nowhere.
How's your love life? Maybe yours needs Ultra Bright. Dynamite taste and more whitener than any leading toothpaste. Ultra Bright, the one that puts sex appeal in a tube, wants to know. How's your love life?
Ultra Bright is available to help yours.
Tonight, why not serve your husband Campbell's Chunky Beef Soup poured over rice? It's got chunks of beef, potatoes, and carrots. Makes a delicious and expensive main dish. Of course, maybe he'd prefer chunky turkey with chunks of turkey poured over noodles. Or, what about chunky sirloin burger? Real sirloin burger and chunks of vegetables poured over toast or biscuits. Or, what about
Campbell's Chunky Soups? Tonight, pour yourself a chunky main dish.
Wide World Special will continue with Charles Manson, a portrait in terror, an unauthorized biography involving station identification.
Robert Blake stars in ABC's new action adventure hit, Beretta, tomorrow night.
Six or three or one? That's the question when you catch the common cold. Then take 12-hour contact. You need six of these cold tablets, two every 4 hours, or three of these cold pills, one every 4 hours, or just one contact capsule for up to 12 hours continuous relief from sneezing, congestion, trips. For aches and fever, these contain aspirin. Contact doesn't. Your choice, six or three or one. Give your cold to contact.
When I come home from school, I wipe my feet,
kiss my mother and get the Smuckers. Smuckers comes in a jar that tells you what flavor it is on the side and why it's good on the side. But I like what's inside. Now sometimes I don't wipe my feet and I don't kiss my mother till later.
With a name like Smuckers, it has to be good.
Back room for Hoffy.
I'm a hot dog freak. That's why I love that quote about Hoffy. Spicy, all beef. It's got to be the best hot dog in the world.
Elvis, tomorrow at 3:30.
The warnings. The demented graffiti on doors and walls provided a field day for the television and the press and for the prosecution. But what's the whole history of the Manson case revealed to psychologists concerned with the problems of youth in our society? In the forefront of their concern is Jeremy Ritzlin, a psychologist for the Center for Adolescent Living, who spent years working with problem teenagers.
Mr. Ritzlin, I've always been curious. As someone who works with troubled kids, do you ever run across potential Mansons, potential Susan Atkins? All the time. What produces such people? Well, I could explain it in terms of some psychological theory, what they call sociopathic or psychopathic behavior. That's probably not the most useful way to go. However, it could shed some light on that kind of personality problem. It goes something like this. We all have some sort of governing mechanism that we call commonly conscience. Freud called it superego. Mm-hmm. That's something that we learn at a very early age, all the do this, don't do that, that we get from our parents, later reinforced by teachers, anybody in authority, society in general. The old theory goes that this mechanism that we eventually incorporate into our own personality systems, which again, as I said, Freud calls superego, we call conscience, winds up being absent or like Swiss cheese has holes in it for people that we label, and I hate to use labels, sociopath or psychopath. That is, they don't experience the remorse and guilt and the conscience that most of us have in saying, hey, we better not do this, this is wrong, this is not right.
This is lacking within them.
Well, I don't really believe it's lacking, but I really think...
It's stifling.
No. I think just the opposite. I think it's a product of very authoritarian parents, fragmented families, very strict kinds of parents. The old saw that permissiveness is responsible for all our problems in American society. The data does not hold that up whatsoever.
No. Okay.
Not at all. I mean, we go into another discussion about what we mean by permissive, but usually all people who are violent had very brutal parents. They were rejected children at birth. They were accidents at birth. And rather than having to incorporate a conscience for themselves that is so strict, so rigid, so brutal in many cases, they deny that they've got it.
But given the soaring divorce rate that we have in this country today, what does this mean? How does this relate for the future of our health and society?
Well, once again, the soaring divorce rate, which is approximately 1 out of 3 marriages ending in divorce and rapidly approaching 1 out of 2, again, if you look at the kinds of people that are really the human wreckage in terms of casualty behavior in American society, you see the disadvantaged, the minority ethnic. If you go to the mental institutions in America, it's a very bad place to go look anyway. Nobody really gets better there. You find that 90% are the category that I described, minority ethnic, disadvantaged, people who live way below the poverty level.
But those girls didn't come from underprivileged homes. Now, where's the fine line? What makes a Patricia Krenwinkel, a Susan Atkins?
Well, if you go back to that period of time, we're seeing great social upheaval and change, people questioning our morality, people questioning the kind of hypocrisy that many of these kids saw in their own families, loveless marriages that were staying together. And incidentally, since that time, we're seeing a phenomenon of middle-aged divorces. People who've been married 15, 20, 25 years, finally deciding to try something new in the world. I'm not saying that's a good or a bad thing. But this was a time when people were questioning the so-called youth revolution, the so-called hippie movement, And people were very fragmented. People were very, very alienated. And they were looking for some kind of group identification, some kind of value set, some system of belief that they could hang on to.
Yeah.
So many of these people that did come from middle-class backgrounds, I used to see this at the free clinic a great deal. They kind of walked away from the middle-class morality and ethic and were trying to find their own. Some good things came out of it. Some very bad things came out of it.
Many bands of kids didn't come from broken homes or disadvantaged homes, and they didn't become criminals. When someone becomes a killer, is it our fault or is it his fault?
Well, we don't have to assess any blame, and I do believe that people need to take responsibility for their own behavior. Nonetheless, if you want to see it in its total context without having to assign blame, if there's going to be any learning that takes place, we ought to look at some of the systems that produce people. And you ask me how come, you know, some of these girls wound up being mass murderers and committing heinous crimes and living a lifestyle that we're very critical about. That's the role of the dice. That's the role of the dice. And they happen to get mixed up with a man, talking about Manson, who had an ability to manipulate women. And these were adolescent girls,
yeah,
in a period of transition with identity crisis.
Right.
They found some common set of values they could identify with, right, and got some group validation that they were okay.
Manson himself, I mean, you go back to what you said, he tried to shift the blame for the killings onto our society and our culture. Are you seeing a path that you agree with him?
No, I don't agree with that. But if you start to look for good guy, bad guy, guilt or innocence, that gets so obfuscated and confused. Would like at least to throw this out as an idea. Manson was 5'2", 5 feet 2 inches tall. Callie was 5 feet 6 or 7. Sirhan Sirhan, short man. Lee Harvey Oswald, short man. And I think that one of the things that we need to look at, when you ask me, do we have to take some blame for this? Not really.
No, Caesar comes.
Sure, we go back to Caesar, yeah, and we go back to Napoleon and all the short men. Other people compensate in more productive ways. Some people wage wars on international scales. I've lost my point.
That was very interesting.
It's come back to me, the point of the kind of things that we stress in society, competitiveness, the kind of values we put on how people look. We don't like short people. Short people, there's a severe prejudice against shortness. People grow up feeling they're inadequate because they're short, because of this accident of nature. I mean, it really shouldn't make any difference. Now you couple this with the kind of terrible fragmentation that Charlie Manson had as a child, the illegitimate son of a 15-year-old girl, I believe, who euphemistically was referred to as a loose woman, apparently. She was able to support herself by having sex or sexual relations with men. He must have learned a great deal of that manipulation from his mother. They wound, from what I've read in a couple books, they wound up being able to manipulate each other pretty good. Manson was sent to aunt and uncle who were terribly strict and religious. Now, they gave him some boundaries and limits, but didn't work. He'd always gravitate back to his mother, whom he couldn't get along with.
In the other,
yes.
Yeah, it's really very interesting. How would you sum up Manson in a single sentence?
A powerless man who was a victim of his fragmented family, a failure in the school system, in the criminal justice system.
Yeah, it's really sad. Thank you very much, Mr. Woodson.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence.